Good morning, let us stand. We want to welcome each and every one of you to Faith and Life Fellowship Ministries, those who are here in person and those who are watching. We give God thanks and praise. So that was a wonderful welcome, but I want you to turn to the person next to you and give them a great smile and say, welcome, Jesus loves you, I love you. We've been practicing our love in our Bible study, and we want to tangibly let everyone know that we love you. Praise God. Praise God. Amen. So now we want to give God a hand clap of praise, for he is good. He's worthy to be praised. I love the scriptures that say, enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. So just right now, just open up your hands, open up your hearts, open up your mouth, and just for a few minutes, even few seconds actually, even before getting into our prayer, just think of all the things that you want to give God thanks for. Just raise your hand. Just give God that praise and that glory and that honor. Just give him his time just before we get into corporate worship, where we just say thank you, where we just say thank you personally for all that he has done. Father God, we come before your throne. We first of all ask forgiveness for all of our sins, all the things that we have done wrong individually and collectively, dear God. We ask your forgiveness, dear God. We ask that you will come afresh and anew in our lives, dear God. Your word talks about being filled with the Holy Spirit continually, dear God. And so, dear Lord, we pour out our cups so that we can be filled it one more time continually, dear God, to the overflow, dear God. We just say thank you, God, for your presence, dear God. We say thank you, dear God, for your Holy Spirit, dear God, that walks with us and talks with us and guides us and comforts us and keeps us day by day. We just say thank you, God. We say thank you for your provision, how you've kept us throughout the week, dear God, how you put food on our tables, dear God, how you paid our mortgages and our rents, dear God, how you put shelter over us, dear God. We say thank you, dear God. We thank you, dear God, for the jobs. We thank you, dear God, for the financial provision, dear God. We thank you, dear God, for the church, your church, dear God, where we can come together and pray, dear God. And we think about Solomon's temple that was built, dear God, for the same reason that this was built, dear God, so that your people can come together, dear God. And when we pray and when we make our appeals to you, dear God, you will hear from heaven and you will answer our prayer. And so, dear God, you call this house a house of prayer. And Father God, as people gather from the north, from the south, from the east, from the west, Father God, may you even elevate their faith, dear God, elevate their expectancy, dear God, of what they will receive in the name of Jesus. Father, dear God, we put this service before you, dear God. We pray that you will bring those who are coming safely, dear God. We pray for those that are watching, dear God, will be attuned and will be attentive. We bind every spirit of distraction, dear God, in the name of Jesus. And Father, you reign supreme, supreme over this house, dear God, supreme over our lives, dear God. And no weapon that is formed against us shall prosper, dear God. We walk in peace. We walk in victory. We walk in love. We walk in unity in the name of Jesus. And we just thank you, dear God, for the word that will go forth. We thank you for the praises that will be lifted up. We pray that you will help we receive them in the name of Jesus. And we just thank you for your presence. We continue to lift you up. May every heart that may be broken, may every heart that may be discouraged, Father God, by the end of this service, may they be uplifted. May they be filled to the overflow. Father God, show yourself up mightily in an uncommon manner in this place today. We welcome you, dear Holy Spirit. We welcome you. We give you thanks and praise in no other name but in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Today's reading is from Deuteronomy 8, 2 through 5, and verse 15 through 16. I'll be reading from the NIV version. And it reads, "Remember how the Lord your God led you all the way in the wilderness these 40 years to humble and test you in order to know what was in your heart, whether or not you will keep his commands. He humbled you, causing you to hunger, and then feeding you with manna, which neither you nor your ancestors had known, to teach you that man does not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of the Lord. Your clothes did not wear out, and your feet did not swell during these 40 years. Know then in your heart that as a man disciplines his son, so the Lord your God disciplines you." And we go down to verse 15 and 16 that reads, "He led you through the vast and dreadful wilderness, that thirsty and waterless land with its venomous snakes and scorpions. He brought you water out of hard rock. He gave you manna to eat in the wilderness, something your ancestors had never known, to humble and test you so that in the end it might go well with you." May God add a blessing to the reading of God's word. Amen. Amen.
Amen. Come on, you can put your hands together for the Lord this morning. Come on and put your hands together for the Lord this morning. Hallelujah. He is worthy to be praised. He is worthy to be praised. Come on and give God some praise. The first song says, "I want to sing a little louder than before." Amen. Oftentimes when we're facing doubts and concerns, it can cloud our judgment. But if we're willing to give God a little praise, a little more than before, if we're willing to exalt his name a little more than before, then we're going to reap more than before. Come on and put your hands together and give God some praise. Before, I want to sing a little louder than before. I want to spin wilder than before. I got to scream louder than before. Say freedom,
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 yeah.
Freedom.
Sometimes we don't understand the kind of God that we serve. We kind of compare him to man all the time. Hallelujah. How could God do this? Man doesn't even do this. I remember I was on a conversation at 2:30 this morning talking to some kids from my school because they were asking, how is it possible God can do this? How is it possible God can do that? And I said, you're trying to think of God through man's eyes. But God is a God whose ways are higher than our ways.
Amen.
Whose thoughts are higher than our thoughts. We can't comprehend
Hallelujah.
The kind of God that we serve. But what kind of God that I serve? All that I know that it is too good to not give him some praise.
Amen.
I may not know everything about God, but what I do know is enough to give God some praise. I just need
Hallelujah.
Everybody to give God some praise this morning.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah!
Hallelujah! Hallelujah! He is worthy of the praise. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! The song says, the Lord is my light and salvation. Who shall I fear? Come on and just lift your hands towards the Father this morning. Hallelujah. We just want to give him the glory and the praise. We want to acknowledge God for who he is, our ever so redeemer. Come on, just let him speak to you this morning.
I will trust in you.
I will trust.
I will see the goodness of the Lord.
Come on, everybody come and say, I will remain.
I will remain confident in this. I will see the goodness of the Lord.
Come on and say,
the Lord is my light and salvation.
Whom shall I?
Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I be afraid?
Come on and say,
trust in you,
because it says, I here in the land of the living, I will see the goodness of the Lord.
I will remain confident in this. I will see the goodness.
I don't know what you're going through today, but
I will remain. I will.
Can we do that one more time? Worship him. Can we just worship him this morning? Because we know that there is no God like the God Almighty that we serve. I mean, we come every week and we say it, but at some point we have to realize and experience and come to the understanding that there is literally no God like the God Almighty that we serve. They have Buddha and they have Allah, but we have the true and living God. We have the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. We have the only, the true, the one living God. And we face battles and situations and problems, circumstances and troubles and trials, you name it. But there is one name. There is one name that is above all names. There's a one name that is above trouble. There's one name that is above sickness. There's one name that is above circumstances. There is one name above financial issues. There is one name. There is one name. There is one name. There is one name. And his name is Jesus. Jesus, there is only one name by which men can be saved. There is only one name who is ruler. He is conqueror. He is warrior. He is mighty. There is only one name that is salvation. There is only one name that is protector. There is only one name that is keeper. There is only one name that is sustainer. There is only one name that is a provider. There is only one name, and his name is Jesus. There's only one. You can put a title on everything you want to put it on in this life. But one name.
Our God is champion. He
on, let's say that again. Say, our God.
And our God is champion. He reigns forevermore. Forevermore.
I like this part. Somebody remember that.
He reigns
forever.
Forevermore.
It doesn't matter the situation or the circumstance.
Forevermore. And our God is champion.
We praise the Lord this morning. We are so happy that the Spirit of the Lord is here. We are so happy that the Spirit of the Lord is here. Because if the Spirit of the Lord is not here, then we are just meeting as a club. But when the Spirit of God is here, there is power. We can expect change. We can expect things to happen. Because where the Spirit is, there's life, there's movement, there's activity. We are happy this morning that we serve a champion God. And there's no God like Jehovah. There is no God like Jehovah. Give him praise. Give him praise. Give him praise. There's no God like Jehovah. And we're going to talk to him right now. Because we have our needs. And as was mentioned this morning, the Lord has set it up that when we come together like this and we present our needs to the Father, he promised to hear. So we're not just gathering for gathering's sake. There's a promise above our gathering. When we come and we make our petitions in the house, he said he will hear from heaven and he will grant our request. So we are here this morning with our various needs. And we are going to make our request to our God who is able. And we are thanking him not only for making our request, but for answering our request. So let us bow our heads in prayer. Father in heaven, we have come as a group of worshipers to praise your name, to exalt you, to lift you up, to tell you thanks, Lord, for the past days of the week that you took us out to our jobs and to our various activities, and you protected us. You preserved us. You provided for us. And now we are back in your house again today to say thank you, Lord, to praise you, to say that there is no God like our God, Jehovah, and that you are champion and that we love you. Father in heaven, as we come and we are different in our faces, we are different in our needs. But we are glad that, as we heard in our Bible study or in our message, that you are a multifaceted God. You can hear my need. You can hear my brother's need. You can hear my friend's need. And though they're all different, you can meet the need of each person. Because you are God and Lord of all the situations that we will ever encounter. So we praise you this morning. We worship you. We adore you. We lift you up. We make you great. And Father, we bring this congregation before you. You know those, O God, who have not yet made a decision to make you their Lord. Because your Holy Spirit is here, we ask that your Holy Spirit will speak to the hearts of each person present in your house. And that those who have not made up their minds to follow you, to serve you, to live for you, your Holy Spirit will draw them to yourself. For we recognize that time is short. We have seen all the things that's happening in our world. And you remind us and told us in your word that these things will happen before you come. And we have seen it, not only wars and rumors of wars, but earthquakes, natural phenomena. And we see all the signs of your coming right here with us. Lord, we pray that we would be awakened out of our sleep, out of our lethargy, because you told us that when you come back, people will be carrying on as usual. They'll be marrying and giving in marriage. They'll be going on with their actual normal situations. But then you will come, and those who are ready will go with you. So we pray that you will stir us up from the inside, that we will not just settle down and mix in with the world and not standing up and standing out for you. So we pray that you will stir us up as we come to your house again today, and help us to see that we need to live a consistent Christian life to be ready whenever you come. We bring our military people before you. God, you see the state of our world right now. You know many of our sons and our daughters are placed in the line of fire. We ask for divine protection over our troops, wherever they are located, in the Mediterranean, wherever they are. We ask for divine protection. We ask for preservation. Most of all, Lord, we pray that you will speak to them and help them to know that the only safety is in Christ Jesus, and that they will accept you as their Lord and Savior. We pray for the leaders of our world. You know all that is happening. We have listened to the news, but we are glad that you are still in control, and that there is nothing that's taking place now that you are not aware of. So Lord, we pray for those war areas where people are running and hiding, where people are suffering. We pray, oh God, that more than anything else, they'll be awakened to the reality that you are still there and you're willing to accept them. Remember those children who are suffering hunger because of all the wars and all the things that's happening. So many young people and children are dying of starvation, while many of us waste food and think that we never have, when there are so many children going to bed without eating. Lord, we know sin has caused a lot of things on the earth, but we pray for mercy. We pray, oh God, that you'll have mercy on us. Cleanse us from our sins and make us that which we ought to be. Help us not to take things for granted. Help us not to be just a routine person, but to be on fire for you, to draw close to you, to have you lead in our lives, so that we can be helpful to those around us who do not know you. Bless us again. Bless the service today, the ministry of your word. God, we pray that you will hide the man of God behind the sacred banner of the cross. Let him speak only what comes from you, through him, Lord, as you use him as your servant to help others into the fold. Bless everything, and we shall praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah.
Good morning, church. Are you excited to be in the house of the Lord this morning? I'm so excited that you are here. Come on, give yourselves a hand and give a bigger hand to the Lord for waking you up this morning and just setting you on your way so you could be here. So we want to just greet everybody. We're so glad that you're here, and we don't take it lightly that you're in the house this morning. Amen. We know many people have passed away during this week alone, and we don't take it lightly that we get to see you again, and we don't want to waste that opportunity. We do have some visitors with us this morning, and I want you to recognize them as they stand when I call their names. Reverend Jerome Harris and Judith Harris, come on, give them a hand. So delighted that you're here this morning. Thank you so much for being here. And we know that you could have been somewhere else, but we want to recognize you this morning. Thank you. And we also have, I could see the resemblance. That's the word. Thank you. The resemblance of the pastor here this morning. Amen. Come on and stand to your feet. We got his kids in the house. So happy. They didn't get to write their names down. You're going to tell me the names? Oh, you got names down. Oh, look at that. They got names. So excited this morning. We have Keone Spry. Come on. Wait, all K's now. You name everybody. Keyshawn Spry.
Y'all so cute.
Keon Spry. Come on, we want to just thank the whole Spry family for being here this morning. And I want you to know that we love you. We appreciate you. Are you ready to greet people and just tell them that you love them? I want you to hug at least 10 people. Can you do 10 this morning? I'm so happy you're here. They're happy they're here. And we want all of our visitors to feel very welcome. And we want you to know that the Jesus in me loves the Jesus in you. Hug 10 people. Make sure all of our visitors feel very welcome. The Jesus in me loves the Jesus in you. The Jesus in me loves the Jesus in you. So easy. And you're so easy. And you're so easy. You're easy to love. The Jesus in me loves the Jesus in you. The Jesus in me loves the Jesus in you. So easy. And you're so easy. And you're so easy. You're easy to love. The Jesus in me loves the Jesus in you. The Jesus in me loves the Jesus in you. So easy. And you're so easy. And you're so easy. You're easy to love. The Jesus in me loves the Jesus in you. The Jesus in me loves the Jesus in you. So easy. You're so easy. You're so easy. You're easy to love. Jesus in me, Jesus in you. Jesus in me loves the Jesus in you. So easy. You're so easy, and you're so easy. You're easy to love. The Jesus in me loves the Jesus in you. The Jesus in me loves the Jesus in you. So easy, and you're so easy. You're so easy. You're easy to love. Love back to your seat. Love back to your seat. Love back to your seats. Love back to your seats. Love, 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 love. Back, 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 back to your seats. Love 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 back to your seats. Love, 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 love. Back, back, back to your seats. To your seats. To your seats. Love back to your seats. Love back to your seats. Love back to your seats, to your seats, to your seats, to your seats. Love back to your seats. Love back to your seats. Love back to your seats. Amen. Come on, give God a hand clap of praise. All right. We have some announcements this morning, and I want you to mark your calendars for all the things that are taking place. Immediately following service today, we do have Sunday school. Amen. So we want to see you all in Sunday school. That's where we can study and ask questions for God's word. Amen. And then this Tuesday night, we do have our ETA classes. Those of you who are in ETA, Tuesday night classes, and some of those are the last sessions, so please make sure to be there and on time. And then on Wednesday night, we do have God Talk. Aren't you excited about God Talk? On Wednesday night, on our Zoom sessions, those are amazing conversations and Bible study, and so we do want you to join us on Wednesday nights. And then we do have two funerals getting ready to come up. And so I'm going to talk a little bit about that, but I want you to mark your calendar for April the 27th. That's the last Sunday, I believe, in this month. Not this coming Saturday, but the following Saturday, we are going to have our health fair. So we do ask that you invite. There are going to be lots of trucks here and available. We're going to need your help and support. I know that food ministry is going to be there this that Saturday. So come on out for food ministry, and at 9 o'clock, the health fair starts. So please be inviting, and please come out and assist with that endeavor. Amen. Also, on your bulletins, you will see that May the 18th, we do have our tea party. So mark your calendars for May 18th, and that's at 4:30, and the tickets are $25. They are on sale already. You can see Sister Betty. Come on, raise your hand, Sister Betty, so they can see you. And make sure that you get your ticket. You don't want to miss it. It's a real nice time. It's a dress-up affair. We drink lots of tea, all kinds of tea, and it's so dainty. Very, very nice. Men and women are invited. There are fashion shows and big events. Amen? So that's at 4:30, and that's May 18th. Okay, mark your calendar, the funeral and wake for Rudolph Francois. We want you to know when it is. It's going to be, the wake is this Friday at Nakia Ingram Funeral Home. Okay, this Friday at Nakia Ingram Funeral Home, and it's going to be from 6 to 8. So all of us will be there. And again, that's going to be at 6701 Pembroke Road, Pembroke Pines, Florida, 33025. Take a picture of the screen. Make sure you know, and that we'll be there to support the Francois family. Amen. And then the homegoing celebration is going to be on Saturday, the 20th, and it's going to be here at Faith and Life. And that service begins at 11 o'clock. Amen. So we want everybody to be in attendance. That's this Saturday at 11 o'clock. And then the repast is going to be following after here. Amen? I know that we want to make sure we support the Francois family. So mark your calendars for those two things, right? Keep it in mind this Friday and then for this Saturday. And all the information will go out on the chats as well so that you are aware and you know what is coming. Also, another friend, church family, there are so many ministers that passed away over this past week. So we want to keep those churches and their families in prayer. Amen. And we don't take it lightly, because when someone from that congregation leaves, and especially the pastor of that church, we want to keep them in prayer. Amen. And we also have Clive Rogers, you know, the Rogers family. They're a family that support our church for many years, the Bethany Baptist Church, and their mother passed away. So we want to keep them in our prayers. The service is going to be April the 27th. So the following week, not this weekend, but the following weekend, is going to be at the same funeral home, Nakia Ingram Funeral Home in Pembroke Pines, and the service starts at 11. Amen. So when you leave from here, from helping with the food ministry and the health fair, we can go straight to the funeral, because we want to make sure we show our support. Amen. For the Rogers family. Those are the morning announcements. We want you to have a blessed Sunday. At this time, we are going to stand for a tithe and offering as Sister Betty Ward comes and she leads us for the offertory prayer.
And somebody, our God is champion. Let me just, this little testimony, quick. This month, we, Wisdom Saints, are responsible for refreshments. So I went to buy some drink. So I went to Publix. And I saw, I'm sorry, I had to buy soda. Buy two and get one free. I said, okay, I hop in on that. And when I went further up the aisle, I saw something that says Publix, 3 for $4. So that's what you're drinking today. Ain't God good? Ain't he a champion? Amen. Amen. Let us pray for the offering. Our God is champion, people. You don't want to get me started. Hallelujah. The children of Israel brought a willing offering unto the Lord, every man and woman whose heart made them willing to bring for all manner of work, which the Lord have commanded to be made by the hand of Moses. And in Joel, he says, I will restore. Anyone he say that? I will restore. And I will restore to you the years that the locusts have eaten, the canker worm and the caterpillar and the palmer worm, my great army, which I sent among you. That's the word of God that he says. Father, in the name of Jesus, we come to bless the offering. Father, you said, bring your tithes and offerings into my house so that it will be filled. And bring it willingly, whether we have much or a little. And see if I don't open the windows of heaven and pour you a blessing. Lord, today your children are in need of a blessing. Lord, we are in need of some restoration. We want financial restoration. God, restore the years that the canker worm has stolen and the locusts, oh Heavenly Father. We need financial breakthrough. Lord, children are in need, oh Heavenly Father. We need jobs and promotions and raises, oh God. Some people need a new car. Some people need a different apartment. Some people need home. Father, in the name of Jesus, we're looking to you because there is no other. You love us. You said you're going to send the rain and the sun, the fall and shine on the just, on the unjust, on the righteous, on the unrighteous. How much more your children who you love, and you will withhold no good thing from them. So, Father, we come willingly before our might and our match today, and I pray for wisdom for all who will spend this money. Help us to be good stewards of what you have given us. The treasurer, the financial committee, the leaders of this church, Lord, give them wisdom how to be good stewards of your money, God, and us also to be good stewards of your money that you lend us for a minute. We bless you and we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Say you can never be the one, but God say, make I tell you, say, say now you him choose. In 1 month, in 1 week, you will sing a new song. In 2 days, unless a dad, you will hear. Congratulations, you're sin. That I can never be all that I see. I've seen that God is greater than that. Who can battle with the Lord?
I found it all in your presence. Now I can stop all the searching. I looked in all the wrong places. 8 billion others, so glad I found you. I found you. So glad I found you. The world can't match what I'm feeling. Glad I found you. Found you, so glad I found you. Ooh. I was a ship without a sail, I could have lost my mind. In the middle of the storm, you pulled me like a tide. And when I thought that it was over, you redeemed the time. This is paradise, now I've got you.
Amen. Let's give God a hand clap of praise again. Amen. Let us pray. Eternal God, our Father, we thank you so very much for your goodness and your grace. Thank you for the privilege of worship. Thank you for the opportunity to gather as a community to worship and to magnify your holy name. We thank you, oh God, for your presence that's in its place. Thank you for worship that has gone forth. Thank you for intercessory prayer that gives us the opportunity to articulate our needs and our concerns. Now, God, we come to share your divine word. We ask, God, that you would open up our hearts to hear. And we ask that you would speak a word into our hearts, God, that we would be better for it. God, we still believe that there is power in your word, that your word has the power to transform our lives. It has the power to shift us. God, ultimately, it has the power to tell us about your awesomeness and your goodness. We thank you, oh God, for your goodness and your grace. God, let the words of our mouth and the meditation of our hearts, let it be acceptable in your sight, oh Lord, our strength and our redeemer. It's in your name we pray. And the people of God said amen. If God has been good to you, clap those hands and give him praise. Hallelujah. We serve an awesome and a mighty God. We thank him for his keeping power and grace. Thank him for allowing us to gather yet another Sunday to worship his holy and powerful name. You can keep playing. You can keep playing. Amen. We thank him for keeping us and allowing us. There's so much that has transpired this last week. Amen. And I'm just grateful that the Lord has kept us and allowed us to come together as a church family, a corporate family, to worship his name. I want to take a point of personal privilege to thank the Harrisons for coming. Let's give God praise for the Harrisons. Amen. They are some of me and my wife's favorite people. Amen. And we're grateful to God that they've come to worship with us this morning. Amen. And to the youngest three of the bunch, amen. Keyshawn, Keani, and Keon. Where'd Keon go? He ran out. He went to the bathroom. Amen. Y'all make sure he come back and sit down. Amen. Amen. Hear me preach this word of God. Thank my babies for being here. Amen. To overseer, let's give God praise for our overseer. Hallelujah. Amen. And to the prettiest lady in the room, fellas, don't get mad. To my lovely wife, amen. Give God praise. I ain't trying to start no trouble. Amen. I'm trying to get me a meal after church. Amen. Amen. Let's get into the word of God. Deuteronomy chapter number 8. And to all our other ministers, amen, that are here. Amen. Amen. Minister Williams and his lovely wife. Minister Francis, amen. To those that served our praise and worship team, amen, our musicians. Deuteronomy chapter number 8. Amen. We're starting a new sermon series called The Paradox of Process, where God can take the bad and make it good. Where he can take a moment of difficulty to produce a better us. Amen. Process doesn't always seem like something is going to come, something good is going to come out of it. But when you put it in the hands of God, God can raise a dead Lazarus out of the grave. He can heal a woman with the issue of blood that was sick for 12 years. And so we want to dive into this particular sermon series, The Paradox of Process. Amen. The contradictory part that God, who is infinite in wisdom, calls us to do stuff, but he never tells us the in-between part. And I don't know. Sometimes I've been mad with God. I just want you to tell me the in-between part. And God says, no. It ain't none of your business. Amen. It's just required of us to trust him. Amen. Through the process. Deuteronomy chapter number 8, verses 2 through 5, and then we'll drop down and read verses 15 through 16. The Bible says, remember how the Lord your God led you through the wilderness for these 40 years, humbling you and testing you, the NLT says, to prove your character and to find out whether or not you will obey his commands. Verse 3 says, yes, he humbled you by letting you go hungry and then feeding you with manna, a food previously unknown to you and your ancestors. Moses says he did it to teach you that people do not live by bread alone, but rather they live by every word that comes from the mouth of God. Verse 4 says, for all these 40 years, your clothes did not wear out, and your feet did not blister or swell. Think about it. Just as parents discipline a child, the Lord your God disciplines you for your own good. Dropping down to verse number 15, he says, do not forget that he led you through the great and terrifying wilderness with poisonous snakes and scorpions, where it's dry and hot. Gave you water from the rock. Moses says he fed you with manna in the wilderness from unknown to your ancestors. He did this to humble you and test you for your own, church shout, your own good. NLT reads like this. He fed you in the wilderness. The CSB rather reads like this. He fed you in the wilderness with manna, which your ancestors had not known, in order to humble you and test you. Here's the part that blessed me. So that in the end, he may cause you to prosper. Amen. I want to talk for the next couple of moments from this particular subject, the intentional path. The intentional path. Ask your neighbor, are you on the intentional path? I know, ask them, amen, amen. They may not answer you, but amen, the intentional path. I want to start this sermon off by admitting that sometimes I struggle with the foreknowledge of God. Y'all know I'm just honest, I'm just going to be honest. That side of him where he knows all things because he determines all things based on his infinite wisdom. This foreknowledge points to God's omniscient nature, where he knows everything. Nothing, of course, is absent of God's knowing, and I don't even know if that's good English. The reason I struggle with this is because it seems as if he sets the course of our lives from this particular idea, his foreknowledge. And you're probably wondering, Pastor Spry, why is this a problem? Here's the issue for me. God knows the exact path we are uniquely placed on. He knows all the details of the path. He knows the impact of the path. And he knows our response to the path. Yet with his foreknowledge, he places us on the path, church shout, anyway. You think, because of all this knowing that he knows, that he would alter the path to accommodate us. But that's not the God that I serve. That whatever path he has ultimately designed for you to be on, he will place you on that particular path. And here's the tension based on this statement that I just talked about, my theological conundrum. He tells our path to accommodate his intended plan, no matter the amount of uneasiness it causes us. Which says to me that the priority is for God to execute his plan, and he's not concerned about how uneasy we'll be on that particular path. We all have or are existing in this middle tension of this intended path of God, where this uneasiness comes seemingly as an accommodation. It's tension because if God puts us on the intentional path, it is because there's a specific purpose and reason behind it. And most times it will be beneficial. Yet that in-between space is what I call process that leads to the path ultimately benefiting us. It is filled with uncomfortable moments. It is filled with the stretching of our faith. It is filled with the deconstruction of our self-sufficiency. That middle place called process is the place in which God puts us on where we'll be absent of God's doing. It'll have us wondering if God has made the right decision concerning the path that he has chosen for us. Church shout, process. That in-between space, the most challenging space that we could ever exist in. But I've come to discover that it sometimes is the blessed place to be in. And that's why I titled this sermon series, The Paradox of Process. Why? Because it's beneficial because it grows us, but it will be painful. It's rewarding when we come out on the other side, but not without agony. It grows us, but not before seemingly it breaks us. It matures us, but not before it exposes our spiritual immaturity. It develops us, but not before it deconstructs our self-sufficiency. Ladies and gentlemen, God's intentional path is really the paradox of process. That which is contradictory in the hands of God, where God can take the bad and turn it around for our good. We just celebrated Jesus dying on the cross of Calvary, and it was the process of the cross that led to paradise. We will not exist in this world without process, and God will use an intentional path to accommodate, to utilize it as a tool to build us up. And I don't know who I'm talking to, but the Lord has called me this morning to share this word that you are on an intentional path. And it may be filled with the paradox of process where you don't know what's going on, but the Lord says that the process is going to work out for you because the path is intentional. And whenever God does an intentional path, it always benefits us in the end. I think I spelled it wrong. Thank you. In Deuteronomy chapter number 8, Moses is literally reminding God's chosen people of this intentional path through the wilderness with this paradoxical process where God uses the difficulty of the journey, the wilderness, for their benefit. When you look specifically at the verses that we selected, you'll discover that God is intentional about the path he placed them on to develop qualities within them that they could have learned in the classroom of the wilderness. They wouldn't have known that God could provide bread without a commercial oven to feed over 4 million people had it not been for the wilderness. They wouldn't have known the character of God and his ability to be a God that sustains if they had not watched this going through the process of the wilderness. God liberates them from 400 years of Egyptian bondage. then places them on a 40-year journey, the wilderness, so they would learn him and develop him in the process, hence the intentional path. And here is what I want to argue. The intentional path is necessary and beneficial, but lived out in the classroom of our own personalized wilderness. We say it again, the intentional path, it's necessary and it's beneficial, but it's lived out in the classroom of our own personalized wilderness. The Lord creates paths and he creates ways for us to become a better version of self. He creates paths, intentional paths, so we can grow in our spirituality. He creates paths and he designs movements for us to journey down so we can understand him on a level that we've never understood him before. It's necessary and it's beneficial. But God is unique in wisdom. He knows the amount of tension to allow the path to create in order for us to become a better version of ourselves. God is so intentional in his wisdom that he'll design an intentional path, watch this, to create us as a better prayer warrior. Many of us have never prayed like we prayed before because the path was so beneficial that it caused us to seek the name of our God. God is so intentional and so used by wisdom that he will create a path that benefits us. But it is in the grueling parts of our process that God says, I want to grow you. I want to develop you. I wouldn't have known faith like I know it now if God had not tailored an intentional path to increase my faith. I would have not known, overseer, how self-sufficiency can get in the way of what God wants to do had he not created the intentional path. It's necessary and it's beneficial, but God will then use the grueling parts of process or the path to develop everything that he has put in you that he wants to bring out of you. The book of Deuteronomy is the last book, the first five books of the Bible. It is also the book that comes right before the historical book of Joshua. It is nestled at the end of the 40-year journey in the wilderness, yet it precedes the journey into the promised land. The reason and the purpose of the book of Deuteronomy is to remind the children of Israel of the law given to Moses on the Mount of Sinai and to the expansion of the law and the commandments that were added right before they go over into the promised land. Let me stick a pin there. God says, if you're going to possess the promise, you need to know how to act. Because truth is, you didn't know how to act in the wilderness. And so right before you get there, Reverend Williams, I need to send a book like the book of Deuteronomy. Y'all don't act like y'all know how to act when God gives us the promise. And so he gives them these commandments because prior to getting over there, he wants them to be reminded of how they're supposed to act. This would act as a reminder of how they're supposed to live in the land of promise, as well as provide guidance on what's required of chosen people when they possess the promise. Another reason for the book of Deuteronomy is the retelling of Israel's history. It contains the recapitulation of the history of the Israelites, including their deliverance from evil, God giving of the law at Mount Sinai. The wandering of the wilderness is a part of their history. Moses is reminiscent of the days in the wilderness. In verse number 2 of chapter number 8, it starts out by saying, remember how the Lord led you through the wilderness these 40 years. This is a moment of theological reflection that all transpired during these 14,200 days in the wilderness. During this reflective moment, they're thinking about a lot. They're thinking about the deconstruction of their Egyptian philosophy. They're thinking about the days of frustration when they were hungry. They were thinking about the theological insight that they acquire. They're thinking about the provisions of God, the promises made, and the character development in this moment. Moses says, remember, church shout, remember. He wants them to remember their encounter. Moses wants them to remember for the sake of reminder of how God uses this unconventional path for such positivity. And here's the catch. They are now on the other side of this experience into the promised land, headed into the promised land. And then God uses Moses as a moment for them to reflect on what came out of this experience. I know they were led out of Egyptian bondage into the wilderness, and God told them that the reason they're coming out is because they're going into the land of promise. But one of the things that God left out was that they were going to be nestled in process between the parting of the Red Sea and going over into the land of promise, that they were going to have to endure 40 years of hard discovery of themselves, 40 years of process of growing in their theology, 40 years of being deconstructed of their own philosophies, 40 years, church shout, 40 years. It was 40 years that they had to endure such process because God wanted to reshift their thinking. He wanted them to grow in their understanding. He wanted them to understand it's not about self-sufficiency, but it's about God dependency. And he used 40 years to teach them about who he was. It was the intentional path for God to show them that I am your God, that I made a covenant with your chosen people back in Genesis chapter number 15, that you would be my people and I would be my God. And the only way you can understand me like you understand me, I got to put you on an intentional path, 40 years of hard times, so you can know that I am God. And sometimes I wrestle with, why does God always overseer seem like you? He uses the hard way to teach us about him. I mean, truth be told, we got 66 books. And Deacon Ken, that's enough to know about God. But God says, no, I'm going to use the Bible, and I'm going to use an intentional path to teach you about me so that you can validate who I am through the Word of God. And God says, I've created the intentional path for you to understand the value of who I am. And many of us, we are trying to get off this intentional path, but the Lord says, no, I'm not letting you off, because there's something you got to discover about me. There is things you got to learn about me. You got to learn faith on another level. You got to learn that I am a way maker, a miracle worker, a promise keeper, a light in darkness. You got to learn who I am, and I'm going to use an intentional path to show you the very essence of who I am. It may be difficult. It may be hard. You may get frustrated. It may seem unfair. But the Lord says, if it's an intentional path, it's going to work out in the end. If it's his intentional path, it's going to show you exactly who he wants, what he wants to show you. Here's a relevant question that must be asked and answered. Why would God choose an intentional path? I'm so glad you asked. First reason he chooses an intentional path, to expose the true essence of your character under extreme circumstances. Oh, I wrote in my notes that y'all would be rejoicing right there, but so let me say it again. Y'all, I need y'all to do different now, okay? My notes said that y'all gonna be rejoicing when I say that, all right? Let's back it up. Here's a relevant question that must be asked to answer. Why would God choose an intentional path? Here it is. To expose the true essence of your character under extreme circumstances. Thank you. Thank y'all for that. Verse number 2 and verse number 3 reads like this. Remember how the Lord your God led you through the wilderness for 40 years. Moses says, humbling you and testing you, to prove your character and to find out whether you or not would obey my commands, his commands. Yes, he humbled you by letting you go hungry. What, no Denny's? What, no Chick-fil-A? Oh, he says, then feeding you with manna, a food previously unknown to you and your ancestors. Faith and life, can we agree that God was already aware of the type of character that the children of Israel would disclose in the wilderness moment? Can we agree that our character under certain extreme circumstances won't catch him by surprise? I mean, he already knows what type of person will emerge when the pressure of your personalized wilderness starts to really affect you. So the question is, why does God use this moment of the wilderness to prove their character when he's already fully aware? And I argue that proving their character was for their knowing and not God. And I argue that God needed to reveal them to themselves. And God uses this intentional path to get it done. They needed to know and see who they were in moments as such. And here's another transition, or translation rather, as we read it in another version, this particular verse, to test you in order to know what was in your heart. And the word heart deals with mind, soul, spirit, and self, which all points to the totality of our character. Another way to put this is the key elements that make us who we are. God says, I'm going to do this to prove who you are. And the intentionality of God when it comes to the wilderness was to show them who they really were. And this would reveal to them, If they would follow his commands, it would reveal to them if they wouldn't act like colored people and get angry when they wanted a biscuit and a sandwich. He was trying to prove to them who they were, because God is infinite and knowing. He already knew how they were going to respond. God wanted the children of Israel to see the true essence of their own character, and he did it on the intentional path of the wilderness. And I know you see me coming. If the intentional path was to prove their character, we are not exempt. God chooses our path as a tool to reveal the very essence of who we are. And I'll be the first to admit, I noticed things about my character that made me say I didn't even know that existed in me when I was faced with extreme circumstances. I didn't know, Faith in Life, how easily agitated things would make me when I was uncomfortable. I didn't notice I would complain and get frustrated when God would allow the pressure of the intentional path to become a lot. I noticed I wasn't the nicest person, and y'all don't ask my wife, she'll probably tell on me. I wasn't the nicest person when I was feeling the pressures of the intentional path. I'm going to be honest, because y'all not going to be honest. There were times when the intentional path revealed stuff about me that I didn't know was in me. There were times where the intentional path showed me the very essence of who I was. And God says, I wasn't doing that to prove something to me. I know I made you. I created you. I wrote your story out. I don't need to know how you are. I need to know how you, so I need you to know who you are. And the goodness of God is he exposes our character under extreme circumstances so we'll know who we are, so we can work on those things that need to be worked on. And I understand the times when things are difficult and challenging, and the Lord says, I'm trying to show you who you are, that you are not as strong in me like you should be. And so I got to use the intentional path so you can see that part of your character that you need to spend more time in my presence. That I'll use the intentional path to show that you're in your character, that you are a grumbler, that you are a complainer, that you're only strong when you walk through the doors of the church. And God says, I'll use the path to show you that really your character needs some improvement. And if y'all to be honest, I'm going to be honest. I needed this intentional path because there are times I needed to know who I was, because I want my ways to please God. And if my character is out of alignment, I need to know how to get it back in line. There are people that walked out of your life and you didn't know you can use bad words like you used them. But the Lord said, I did it to show you your character. Some of us were betrayed by certain individuals and we didn't know how unforgiving we was until we experienced the intensity of the path. And the Lord says, the path is beneficial. It's necessary because it's going to prove your character. It's going to bring those things to the surface so you can work on them with the help of the Holy Spirit. The Lord says, I'm not allowing your character to be exposed for you just to have a working knowledge of it. No, I'm doing it so you can be a better version of yourself. And stop complaining about the path. And somebody shout, I got to work on myself. The Lord says, I created the intentional path to expose the true essence of your character under extreme circumstances. Some of us do good because we're resilient like that. We know how to bounce back. We're strong. Ain't nothing like when the pressure of life starts to really weigh you down and you begin to see the true essence of who you are. Second thing, and I'm done, about this intentional path is that it teaches us that sustainability comes through the power of his word. Somebody shout sustainability. Sustainability. Lord takes them on this journey to teach them about sustainability. But he wanted them to understand that sustainability comes through the power of his word. Verse 3 says, yes, he humbled you by letting you go hungry and feeding you with manna, a food previously unknown to your ancestors. He did it to teach you that people do not live by bread alone. Rather, we live through every word that comes out of the mouth of God. All these 40 years, your clothes didn't wear out, neither did your feet blister or swell. 40 years, God kept his chosen people while they're journeying in this, on this intentional path, this process moment. For 40 years, he gave them what they needed in order for them to be sustained while they were growing in their understanding of him. And one of the ways he sustained them was by giving them manna. Manna was not those Red Lobster biscuits that we love. Y'all know, y'all send the waitress out, go get me some more. Manna wasn't those good tasting biscuits. Manna is what I call, what is that bread? Based on the Israel's first encounter with manna in Exodus chapter number 16. It was literally bread from heaven. And if you ask me, it's miracle bread. Because God didn't use these recipes we get off the cooking channel. No, he used his wisdom to make manna and give it to his children. It was their source or chief source of food until they got into the promised land. The providential essence of God is identified in the fact that he gave them natural food to sustain them physically. Moses wanted to be clear about this whole idea when it came to manna, this miracle bread. And the clarity is, it wasn't really manna that was sustaining you when you were hungry. When God supplied it, Moses says it was really the word of God that kept you and sustained you. And I'm sure if you're like me, you're probably wondering, and Moses, they were probably saying, what you mean? Moses says, yep, it was his word and not this bread from heaven. And one scholar put it like this, Israel's food in the wilderness was decreed by the word of God. They had manna because it became by way of God's command. And therefore, ultimately, it was the bread that kept them. It was not the bread that kept them alive, but it was God's word. It was God's word. He spoke manna into being and it came about. He spoke the means in which it would be given to them and it came about. He spoke the amount that would be needed for all these people and it came about. God knew exactly how this to distribute the word based upon his word. It was all spoken by the word of God. That's how they were sustained. Mm-hmm. He gave them manna as a way to eat and be sustained physically, but it didn't happen. It wouldn't happen if he had not spoken into being. And many of us are trying to figure out how are we being sustained. Can I suggest that you are being sustained by the power of his word? That God will speak promises concerning your life and we'll start seeing things manifest. It's not the tangible that indicates that God, that you're being kept. It's his word that produces the tangible, that it's an indication that it's his word that's sustaining us. And I don't understand why we gotta tell Christians to read their Bibles. I don't understand why it's so hard for us to pick up this good book that tells us about God. If you want to know how to be sustained and kept, it's found in the 66 books. If you want to learn how to be sustained, you got to learn how to search through the archives of scripture and look at how God was a very present help in the time of trouble. You want to know how you're sustained? It's found through his word. It's found through all the commands and the scriptures that God has given us. And the Lord says the intentional path is to teach you about sustainability. And many of us are trying to find out and wonder, it's the word of God that's keep you. He's a very present help in the time of trouble. The word of God says, I'll never leave you, neither will I forsake you. I'll stand with you. He's the God that kept them through the wilderness. It's his word that keeps us. And is there anybody that's excited about the sustainability of his word? If God has commanded his word to keep you, you're going to be kept. And I don't care what the path is suggesting. It may suggest that you might not survive it, but the devil is a liar. The Lord says, my word will override the status of your path. My word will prove that I got all authority in my hand. My word, church, shout my word. My word will tell you that when you are in between the paradox of process, that middle place of struggle to get to where God ultimately wants you to get. Overseer, we got to remember that it's his word that keeps us. It's not your degree. It's not your good looks. It's not your circle. It's not you going to the gym every other day, but it's his word that's going to keep you. And we ought to rejoice that there is power in his word. His word will keep us and it will sustain us. You may be on your intentional path and the Lord says, I've designed it because I want to prove your character. I want to prove to you that you need work, but that's okay. You're going to be better in the end. You're going to know how to stand stronger. You're going to know how to persevere longer. You're going to know how to trust him with a faith you never had. The Lord says, I'm showing you your character. I'm showing you what's in you because I want you to learn how to be kept on this journey. And the Lord says, my word is going to keep you while you're in between process, while you'll be in between the intentional path. The Lord says, I got something that's designed to keep you. Open up my word. Dive into my word. My word will keep you and it'll show you the very essence of who I am. Clap those hands and give God praise. The intentional path. I'm done. God says, I chose the intentional path under this paradox of process because I want to reveal your character. As a matter of fact, it says, I want to prove your character. I want to show you the very essence of who you are. And many of us, we need our character exposed because we're acting in ways, and God says, I'm doing that not so you can fall victim to what I expose, no, so you can better who you are. And I'll use the intentional path. And I've discovered when Jesus was in the Garden of Gethsemane and he was having a human moment, his character was exposed. He was a man of perseverance. That no matter, even when I feel like passing this cup, says, not my will be done, but your will be done. And Jesus teaches us about the endurance of a person under extreme circumstances. It shows us what character is like in hard moments. And I don't know who I'm talking to, but the Lord says your character is going to be better after the storm in which you experience. Your character, church, shout your character. Your character is going to be developed through this. And God doesn't just choose paths because he doesn't have anything to do. He chooses it because he has intention and purpose. And if it's to show your character under extreme circumstances, he's going to do that. And the Lord says, and I'm done, that he wants to teach you that sustainability comes through the power of his word. that his word has the power to keep us and not our tangible belongings. Let us stand. Amen. Let us stand. The intentional path. Hallelujah. The Lord led me to introduce this particular series because we live what Dr. Curtis Williams called the gray area, that middle tension. Our lives are not always in black and white. We exist sometimes in the middle tension. We're in between where we're headed and where we're going. We're in between where God wants us to be. And that middle place is the place where we experience the most difficulty. And here is the theological challenge. It's God that's orchestrating our steps. It's God. I know we like to blame everything on the devil. Story told, man rides up to the church and the enemy, the devil, was sitting on the steps. He was, what was it, upset. And so the man asked, well, why are you upset, Dr. Young? He says, because people in that church always blames me for everything. And that's the truth. We blame him for everything. But what if God has you where you are? What if it's him that has you where you are? For the betterment of who you shall become. And if you find yourself in that middle space, that paradox of process, and you're struggling, I ask that you come now and come to the altar so we can pray as a corporate family, because I, as the pastor, know what that middle place is. I know the difficulties of process. I know the challenges of God revealing my character. There were times I was mad at God because it was after I gave him a yes, I started experiencing some of the worst trials in my life. And he was showing me that I was trying to develop you. If you're in that middle place on your intentional path and you just want some encouragement and some prayer, we ask that you come to the altar. We're going to pray together. As a matter of fact, I'm going to ask Lady Spry to come pray for us. Amen. If that's you, y'all don't be ashamed. Amen. If you're in that middle place and you're struggling with process and you're struggling with what the Lord has allowed you to experience, ask that you come now. And here's the hard truth. We can't avoid it. We can't outlive it. Look at your neighbor and tell them, you got to go through it. You got to go through. You got to go through the process. But the good thing is that God is working it for our good.
Father, in the precious name of Jesus, God, we thank you for gathering us together on this day. God, thank you for the word for today. God, we thank you for the reminder that you are God in all circumstances, in all situations. You never change. You never fail. You always are all powerful. You always are ever present. And God, we pray for each and every one that is in a process, God. We understand that life is a process in itself, God. And that when we give you a yes, you set us on an intentional path that is not always easy, God. That is not always light, God. That is not always understandable to us, God. But we also understand that you have given us 66 books filled with your promises over our life. And your promises are yes and amen. No matter what our process entails, no matter what our process looks like, God, no matter what it feels like at times, God,
We stand before you, trusting you, believing you, God, surrendering to you, God, intentionally, God, knowing that we serve a God that is powerful enough to take us where we are, from where we are, to our destiny that you have pre-planned for our lives. God, it is hard in that in-between place. We come to you honest and transparent, saying that, yes, we believe the promise, but God, between the promise and the manifestation is difficult. It is challenging. Sometimes we shed tears, God. Sometimes we carry hurt, God. But we stand at the altar bringing all of that to you. You said your yoke is easy and your burden is light. So God, we trade, God, our pain. We trade our grief. We trade our hurt, God, for your joy, for your unspeakable, understanding joy, God. And we trade it, Lord God, for your yoke. God, strengthen us. Empower us for the journey. God, work on our character. God, make us the people that we need to be to draw this lost world to you. God, mold us and shape us and make us into the salt and the light of the earth that we need to be. God, not only to sustain ourselves, but God, to draw those around us back to you. And God, we still right now, in the middle of process, we give you all praise and we give you all honor and we give you all glory that is due your name. In Jesus, the risen Christ's name, we pray. If you believe him, if you trust him, give him a praise on this day. Open your mouth and give him a praise. Open your mouth and give him glory. Open your mouth